Hi, today I wanted to do an introduction video to our new TVS-AIh1688ATX. This unit is replacing our TVS-H1688X that we've had on the market for a number of years. Very similar familiar form factor, but the insides are much improved, a lot of changes. So we'll go through all of the different options and things that you can do with this NAS. There are two versions. So we'll jump straight into sort of the big features, which is the new Intel Core Ultra processor. So you get to pick from a couple of different options, which we'll go through on the next page. You've got dual USB 4 Type-C ports on the back, and they do also support Thunderbolt. So if you've got a Thunderbolt 3 or 4 connection, you can connect with those. The max RAM has jumped up. The previous one was about 128 gig max. This one will go up to 192. And a big change is around the four 2.5-inch bays on the front. Previously, they were SATA only, and we had two separate M.2 NVMe slots inside the unit. So you had to unscrew the chassis to get to those. But now we've upgraded those to support not only SATA, but they also support 2.5-inch U.2 NVMEs. Or you can use some adapters if you wanted to still use M.2s. You can put them on a M.2 to U.2 adapter in those bays. It does have two 10 gig copper-based ports, so RJ45 style ports, as well as the two 2.5s, which is quite similar to the last one. It did have two 10 gigs before. Previously, the 10 gigs were added via the PCIe slot. So out of the three PCIe slots available in the NAS, one was kind of taken straight away. On this one, they're on the motherboard, so those three PCIe slots are free from day one, so you can put up to three separate PCIe cards in the back. So we'll just show you the options here between the two units. So the first one is on the left there, which is the U7 with 32 gig of RAM, so the Intel Core Ultra 7, 32 gig standard RAM. And really the only difference to the other one is the other one's got the Ultra 9 CPU with 48 gigs of RAM. Ultra 9 obviously being a better CPU, it's just got more cores, more threads, higher clock speed, things like that. But the ultimate max RAM on them is the same, and the rest of the features are the same between the two units. We do also have an option to upgrade to Thunderbolt 5. So as I said before, if you've got a Thunderbolt 3 or 4, you've got the hardware in the NAS already with the USB 4 ports. But if you want to have the improvements that come with Thunderbolt 5, we will be doing a card that's coming out toward the end of the year that you can push in and upgrade. But we'll talk about that a bit more later on. So there's the USB-C ports that are USB 4, so they are labeled as USB 4, the bottom two Type-C ports. The top two are just standard USB ports, so USB 3.2 Gen 2, so 10 gig a second, but we do have the USB 4 slash Thunderbolt 3, 4 ports there at the bottom. So they are the ones at the bottom that you can use to directly hook up your computer directly if you've got a Thunderbolt port, or you can attach our USB 4 JBOD expansions that we've got coming at the end of the year as well. Here's just a little performance test that we did. So we did the test on the left is with two 10 gig ports. The one on the right is with six 25 gig ports. So performance, absolutely massive, quite a bit faster than the unit it's replacing, but it is several years newer. But down at the bottom there, if you want to pause it, there's the test environment we used to get there as well. The HDMI port has been updated as well. So I think before it was a HDMI 1.4, now it's up to HDMI 2.1. The graphics much improved, so it's up to 2 gigahertz clock speed on there with the Intel Arc graphics. The specs may be slightly different between the U7 and the U9, but these are the U9 figures that we've got here. What the NAS looks like from the front view, with everything labeled up there. So you do still have the one-touch copy button with the USB port, power buttons in the same place. The layout is much the same as the previous unit. Looking around the back, again, the 10 gig ports are on board this time, so your three PCIe slots at the top are free. Whilst it looks like there are four PCIe slots, and we've just not circled one there, it's a double slot. So if you wanted to put a double width card in there, like a graphics card upgrade or something like that, and it takes up the two slots, you can remove that bottom of the longer two blanking plates there so that it can accommodate that. But there is no PCIe slot in there as such. The slot is at the top, so that's where the card would plug in. But that's how that's done there. But yeah, you can see all the different options and the HDMI 2.1 port as well. The PSU's also been upgraded by a couple of hundred watts as well to help you accommodate the sort of more power-hungry graphics cards that you may need if you are upgrading that. Here's a small comparison. So for all the detail, it might be best to pause, but between the unit it's replacing and the two options we've got now, one of the things I will draw your attention to is at the top right, which is the sort of CPU MAC benchmark score. So the previous CPU, the W1250, was just under the 14,000 mark on that, whereas here on the Intel Core Ultra 9, we were able to get over 57,000. So quite many times improvement there on the performance. As we've highlighted some of the red things there where things are a bit better on the newer units compared to the older units. As we go down through the list, we do have all much the same. We are losing two of the 2.5 gig ports. So if you did want the four 2.5 gig ports, they're not there anymore. So we have done the two 10 gig and two 2.5 gig now. But the PCIe slots are massively improved. So we've jumped them up from Gen 3 times 8 as the fastest one to a Gen 4 by 16. So that's about four times faster than the previous one. So Gen 4 by 8 would be twice as quick as Gen 3 by 8. And because we've gone up to the time 16 as well, it's doubled again. So it's much, much faster. And again, we've got a couple of hundred watts extra on the PSU. So that sort of moves into the next page here, which is what you can use that extra power for. So we do have some spare power connectors inside the NAS off the PSU available for you for depending whichever type of network graphics card that you go with. We've got a 6-pin connector and there's a 2-pin connector that you can put together to make a full 8-pin connector if your graphics card does require it. And again, the PSU being 750 watts, way above what the NAS itself needs, it does allow you to put in a power-hungry graphics card, and we can supply the power for that. So this is just about the Thunderbolt 5 upgrade card that you can do. So it does have the Thunderbolt ports built in for Thunderbolt 3 or 4 down at the bottom. But if you wanted to upgrade to the QXP-T52P card, it's a low profile bracket installed as standard. But when you buy it, you do get a full height bracket in the box with it as well. So if you did want to put it in the slots, the longer slots, you can do that if you were using the smaller slots for something else. But each of these cards will give you up to two Thunderbolt 5 ports in the NAS, so very easy to upgrade. Here's a little performance test that was done with the Thunderbolt 5 card inserted, so able to get some pretty good speeds there for anything that you might want to do, 4K or 8K video editing. A couple of people connected directly to the NAS that way, and others can be connected through the 10 gig interface or any other network card that you put in. It does support 25 gig and 100 gig cards that you can add into the NAS as well. So now we'll sort of over with the presentation slides now. So what I'll do is sort of my usual thing here is I'm going to set the NAS up from scratch. So it's a factory reset NAS here, and we're going to go through the full setup wizard. This one is the first NAS that we've got that's running our H5.6.0 firmware. So when we go through here, we'll start the installation. We'll accept terms. Just click. Got it up there. So it's already on the latest version. There is no newer versions for this, but this is the only NAS currently running the H5.6.0. I believe the normal release path is on H5.2.7 at the moment, whereas if you're using our HA from one of our previous videos, I think that's up at H5.3.1 now. But yeah, we've got this version on this one. So we'll click next. I'm going to call it something, so I'll just put the name of the NAS in here. So just as I usually do, very unimaginative. So we'll put that there. Username, I'll put Craig. Put in a password. Okay, and click next. I'm happy to synchronize with the time server that's suggested there, so we'll click next. For this one, I'll just let it obtain an IP address automatically. Here's the Thunderbolt option. So if you were next to the NAS, you would be able to connect directly with the Thunderbolt. So it's telling me I'm disconnected because I am not connected with Thunderbolt right now. Firmware updates, do you want them to update automatically or not? So there's a few different options you can do here. I'll leave it on the default. Tell me that there's an update, but don't do the update. I'll choose when to do the update. So we'll click next. Just a quick summary of all the choices I've done, and then I'll click apply. Warning that it's going to empty the drive, clear the drives. So if you do have data on your drives before you put them in the NAS, this is going to erase them. So I'll click initialize. And that's going to start the process now. It's going to go through the wizard, show me some information for reading sakes and reading purposes, so I can read that if I need. What I'll do here is I'll just let it go through the process. We'll probably put this bit on fast forward, but no cuts. We'll just put it on fast forward. And when we come back, we'll continue with the setup and log into the interface. Okay, so that's the setup complete now. So we'll go to the NAS management, which will open up a new browser tab. So we can close this one now. And this is going to allow us to log in. You've got a couple of different login methods here. You can log in with your QNAP ID or just the username that you created. So that's the one I'm going to use, the user that I typed in at the setup process. Just a few agreements to do. Got to scroll and click continue. Just giving you a little walkthrough of the interface to show you everything that's there. It's going to open default up into Storage Manager. And in here, we've got some guides of things we want to do. So in the notice board, it's telling you sort of the get started steps that we're going to do. We can do a couple of those here at the start. So here in storage space, we're able to come up here and do create a new storage pool. Now, for best performance, it is recommended to have the first storage pool done on a pair of SSDs at least in RAID 1. You can use any combination you like, but the best performance will give you with SSD. So I'm going to choose here that we're going to use two drives because it's chosen SSD and I've got two SSDs inserted. I'm going to choose RAID 1. We'll click next. It's going to pick the drives. So these are some nice Kingston 3.84 terabyte DC3000 series drives. U.2 NVMe work great. So I'm going to click here, go next. Get to choose all your provisioning options, any functions. You can add in pool description if you want, so you can type that in. Click next, and I'm going to click create. Click OK. So that's going to go off and create my first storage pool, of which it will create volumes and things like that. This will take a good while because it's got to not only create the pool, create the RAID, it's also got to do an optimization on the drives. So it's going to do this optimization process, which will take 5 to 6 minutes to do. But while that's doing that, I can talk about some other things. So the NAS itself does have, with the combined CPU, MPU and GPU, it does support up to 36 TOPS, so that's tera operations per second for the AI. So combined with those, our nearest other NAS, which would be our AI NAS, the TS-AIh1688ATX, I believe, this unit is 77% faster at doing things like photo recognition, so for recognizing faces, object detection, things like that. So 77% faster than our other NAS. And when it comes to things like our surveillance applications, so whether you're using QVR face or QVR human to detect people or monitor spaces with the with IP cameras, it does support 20 cameras for real-time QVR face image recognition, and it also supports 24 cameras for doing real-time analytics through QVR human. So really powerful combination there of things that you can do with that processor. But that's the main setup. We can go in here, we can look at the control panel, see the specs of the NAS. So nice Ultra 9. It's got the single 48 gig module in there so that you do have up to three extra slots to upgrade to the maximum of 192 in this one. But this is a very nice spec. All the information here about temperatures of everything, everything's running nice and cool, so that's good. Tells you the fan speeds. We are able to spin the fans quite slowly on this. We've got quite a lot of fans in the back of the NAS. They're quite large, so we can spin them very slowly for really good airflow. So for a NAS of this size, it is really quite quiet. But yeah, that's how you really get up and set the NAS up. So that's going to go off and set up the storage pool, set the volumes up, allow me to use the storage. You can come through here, look at the disk. So here I've got the Kingston DC3000s. Down here I've got some WD 20 terabyte Red Pros that you can add. Lots of bays free to add other things. Two bays free in the 2.5-inch bays if I wanted to do something like an SSD cache. So we've got cache acceleration options over here that I can add. But yeah, for anybody not familiar, this is what the new storage manager looks like. So very, very simplified, very easy to do all the settings. But yeah, that's the new TVS-AIh1688ATX. So I will just put up on screen here for the end. I'll put up the information about the comparison between this one and the other unit for anybody that wants to still see that. So anybody that had the 1688X, it's a significant upgrade from that. Our plan for videos going forward, we'll probably do a separate video on this NAS demonstrating the Thunderbolt 5 connectivity when the QXP T52P card comes out. We'll probably do a Plex video to demonstrate how it can do transcoding with the built-in hardware. And we'll also do another video demonstrating How the AI intelligence works on it for things like QMAGI and possibly with QVR human and QVR face for the camera connections as well, just to show you how all of that works and the advantage of using this NAS over, say, another NAS. Okay, so that's the TVS-AIh1688ATX. If anybody has any questions, do let us know in the comments section down below, and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. Thanks a lot. Bye.